Okay.
Thank you, Franco. Thank you for the organization. Yes, this is my first physiotherapy conference, and I was asked to talk about the role of the brain in running fatigue. But having said that, most of the all of the things I'm going to talk about are applicable to any endurance activity, not just running. Anything from 75 seconds up to multi-days events, you can apply what I'm going to say to all of them. So, but first of all, every time you, which is a bit of a, especially when you don't have many minutes to talk about, when you talk about fatigue, you always have to start by defining what you mean by fatigue, which is a big problem in our field because there are many kind, people use the same word fatigue, but to refer to a very different phenomena. So it's very, very important when you talk about fatigue, when you read about fatigue, to know exactly what you're talking about, to provide an operational definition. And there are many out there. Even in, just in exercise physiology, there are three main ones, which we'll see today. But in clinical medicine, there are even more. So, but the one I'm going to focus today, which is directly relevant to performance, is this definition of fatigue, which is actually the very original one in exercise physiology. So the failure to maintain the required or desired force, velocity, power. And usually when this kind of fatigue occurs, when the person cannot maintain the required or desired workload, we call it exhaustion or task failure or point of fatigue. And this is a bit of an extreme example. This is Paula Radcliffe, still the world record holder for the marathon, female marathon, when in Athens she pulled out of the marathon because obviously she couldn't perform at her desired pace. Bit of an extreme example, but this is happens all the time in any competition. These are the data. A bit slow. These are pacing data, velocity data, from the 2008 Beijing Olympic men 10K race. Obviously, the speed changes quite a lot during the race. This is the distance. But as you can see, so the bold line is the winner. And the other lines are kind of mean data of a group of, I think, five people each going down from the first, from the winner, down five places each. And as you can see here, this group of people couldn't maintain the pace of the winner. These people dropped here. These people dropped here. And the last one, silver medal, dropped there. So every time somebody, because the way we measured this fatigue in the lab is called time to exhaustion test. We just put people on a treadmill, on a bike. We ask them to cycle or run or row, whatever the activity is, for as long as they can. And everybody says, yeah, but that is not really relevant to endurance performance because you don't pace yourself. Well, there are obviously some competition, there are time trials, but most competition you compete against an opponent or more than one opponent, and you don't decide the pace 100%. You need to outpace your opponents in order to win. So it's not totally self-paced. So this kind of fatigue is absolutely relevant to competitions, as you can I demonstrated, hopefully. So the question from a scientific point of view is why? We can assume, being the final of the Olympics, that all of the participants were highly motivated to do well in the race. So motivation shouldn't really be a problem. I'm sure they gave their maximal effort. So why? Why do you think that these people were not able to keep up with the winner and therefore lose the gold medal and the other medals that were available? Assuming the motivation was the same and maximal in all of them. Give me just a typical undergraduate sports science student or typical coach or, I guess, sport physiotherapist answer. No? Nothing? You talk about a lot of muscle fatigue related to injury, I guess, but most people would talk about muscle fatigue. Going back about 100 years, people thought and still think, if you ask an undergraduate student, even in my university, probably tell you something about muscle fatigue, the inability to deliver further oxygen to the mass, so they're building up of lactic acid, impairing, leading to muscle fatigue and impairing performance. However, we kind of, some people say, oh, this is a brainless model of fatigue, and it's true, but you're talking about 1926. Actually, since the 50s, and a lot in the 60s, 70s, especially in the 80s, there's been a lot of research on another kind of fatigue, really slow, which we call central fatigue. So, just a recap. So this is what we were talking earlier. So limitation in the delivery of oxygen, affecting the locomotor muscles, causing, it's not only actually lactic acid, there are a lot of things going on in the muscle that impair the ability of the muscle to produce power. But as I said, in recent years, we know that there is also a lot of involvement from the, well, actually, from the central nervous system. Actually, most of the fatigue is probably in the spinal cord, in the motor neurons, rather than the brain. But regardless of where the impairment is at the brain or spinal level, this leads to a reduced ability to recruit the muscles, and that's central fatigue. And both peripheral fatigue and central fatigue contribute to the decline, exercise-induced decline in power output, which we call muscle fatigue, and then the impairment in performance. And you probably think I'm going to talk about this, but I'm not. Because you will see in a minute why. So the assumption is that people fail to keep up the desired power output because progressively, there is this development of fatigue, both peripheral or central level, doesn't really matter from a functional point of view. But when the decline in maximum power output due to fatigue is so big that the power output coincides with the desired or prescribed one, then exhaustion occurs, or task failure, or fatigue, whatever you want to call it. That's the assumption. And based on this, I mean, these theoretical models are not just, you know, for us academics to have debates and teach our students. They actually have real impact on athletes. So that way of thinking about fatigue, you know, this physiological, I call it the physiological model of fatigue, has had a lot of practical application. For example, basically all endurance athletes are tested for the maximum amount of oxygen that they're able to deliver and consume, which is VO2 max, lactate threshold. We make sure that they have plenty of glycogen in the muscle before they start the race. And even things like doping have been inspired by that way of thinking. In fact, the most famous doping in endurance athletes is EPO, which is a substance that helps oxygen delivery by stimulating production of red blood cells. So theory is important. This is what I'm going to talk about mainly, but it has a practical impact. So there is a problem, though, with that model, and it's in the very basic assumption. So this has been the assumption, as I said, for 100 years and still is for most of my colleagues. However, when I went to look for in the literature to find, okay, where is some empirical evidence of this, I couldn't find any. So that's strange. So I just took a couple of undergraduate students, a very simple study to do, and I put a group of 10 fit, they were kind of rugby players, and give them money if they did well, motivated them a lot to push really, really hard for as long as they can on a bicycle, and measured their maximal power at different stages of the, we call it this time to exhaustion exercise. And this is what we found. So we found significant muscle fatigue, so as expected, and again, because of peripheral or central causes, probably mainly peripheral, but also some central fatigue, but we had this nice and significant reduction in power output. So fatigue was clearly there. The issue, though, for the physiological model of performance is this one, is that even immediately after exhaustion, there was a significant difference between the power at which they were exercising and the maximal power that they were producing. So basically, immediately after exhaustion, they were able to produce a much higher power output. So it means that from a muscle fibers and muscular point of view, the muscle was able to produce way more power than the power at which they were cycling to exhaustion. And also the central nervous system was able to increase the recruitment. And this finding has now been replicated by other groups, including people that were very skeptical about this data. They replicated them and they found the same. Although maybe slightly difference in the difference because of the methodology used, but the bottom line is that you always seem to have like some sort of a reserve in your skeletal neuromuscular system. So then we have to provide, okay, if it's not muscle fatigue that causes the failure to keep up the pace, what is it then? And as Franco was saying, I kind of integrated a variety of disciplines in trying to give an answer to this. And I'll go through it in a very simple way because of lack of time. It's very annoying, this thing. Okay, here we go. So I call it the psychobiological model because it's articulated in two levels. But first of all, the very first principle is this, that when I look at, as my colleagues, or when I was a pure physiologist myself, when I look at somebody doing an endurance test, I always looked at some sort of like a biological engine that, you know, that transform energy into mechanical power. But actually now I see it as a behavior. And even a simple test is actually a complex behavior, not to mention competition against opponents. So, and the science that studies behavior is not physiology, it's psychology. So you should be able to explain endurance test and competition using the theories and constructs of psychology, and I call this a psychological level of explanation. But of course, I'm a physiologist, I want to know, okay, where does this psychological constructs come from a neurophysiological point of view? Because my assumption is that our psychology, our mind, is generated by the brain, doesn't come out of nothing. So I want to understand what's going on there, and that's a biological level of explanation. So as I said before, we test this in the lab using time to exhaustion tests, but the question is exactly the same. Why do they stop? Why can't they keep going at the pace that we give to them? Now, by the way, this is a professional cyclist. I cannot even do a VO2 max at that. So the main cost, there are two main constructs. One is perception of effort. You saw already a little bit of that, which is the perception of basically how hard it is to exercise. You can use a variety of scales. We also use although it was speaking in German, but I think I understood it was talking about also coaches' observation is important. Indeed, we did some studies with facial electromyography to measure the facial expression of effort, and it correlates quite well with the perception of effort reported by the athletes. So actually, there is a bit of a validation for just coaching, just looking at the athlete and guessing how effort they are put into an activity. However, perception of effort per se is not a measure of fatigue. A lot of people get it wrong. For example, if this lady here tries to lift me, she will give me a very high effort. And that's not because she's fatigued. It's because I eat too many pizzas and I'm too fat. Okay? So per se, perception of effort is not a measure of fatigue. It's a measure of how much effort you are exerting in doing any task. And to lift me, it takes a lot of effort. That doesn't mean she's fatigued. What I mean by fatigue related to perception of effort is the increase in perception of effort that occurs over time when you are maintaining a certain pace. And this is the study I showed before. So they were cycling at 242 watts. And over time, you see a progressive increase. And this is very important because if, from a purely psychological point of view and theoretical point of view, if perception of effort didn't increase over time, we could keep a pace corresponding to 19 forever. The problem is that perception of effort increases over time, and this is the fatigue that is relevant to my psychobiological model. But now we have to explain how can this perception of effort cause exhaustion? And in order to do that, you need to introduce another constant, which is potential motivation, which comes from this theory, which is a psychological theory that has nothing to do with exercise. It's a general psychological theory. It's called motivation intensity theory. And it has a lot of implication for psychology, but it'll be very briefly, and I'll talk about potential motivation, which is the maximum effort one is willing to exert in order to succeed in the task. And of course, as I said before, when we are talking about the final of the Olympics, I assume that all the athletes were willing to exert their true maximal effort. Not always like this, obviously, during rehabilitation, during training. Because to maintain a very high level of motivation day in, day out, as you know, is not, as even some athletes struggle with that. But for the in terms of performance, you can assume that highly motivated people will be willing to exert the maximal effort. And this is exactly what we see. But what happens is when the effort required by the task coincides with potential motivation, there is what we call task disengagement. People withdraw effort. And this is what happens when you do a test like a time to exhaustion test. You see a progressive increase in perception of effort. And when, in this case, we're highly motivated, when they reach a very high perception of effort, they disengage from the task. So this is the psychological explanation. Okay, how can we test whether this explanation is valid or not? Basically, the best way to do it is to change perception of effort and see what happens to time to exhaustion in a way that doesn't change the physiology that we traditionally think determines endurance, determines the time to exhaustion. Because obviously, for example, I can tell you, if I go at altitude, my time to exhaustion at the same power up will be reduced because I'm in hypoxia. And I also feel more effort when I cycle or in hypoxia. But then you could say, okay, but that's because you have more muscle fatigue. So you cannot dissociate perception of effort from muscle fatigue. It could be both explanation, who knows? So you need to use some manipulations that have an effect only on perception of effort. If the psychobiological model is correct, we should see changes in performance. If the limit is within the muscles or the central nervous system, changing perception of effort without changing muscle fatigue or the physiological factor that determines it, it shouldn't have any effect whatsoever. So let's have a look. First study I did was on mental fatigue. So we did a time to exhaustion test, very high intensity, the kind of exercise that is really, we think, is limited by lactate, VO2 max, all these kind of things. But before that, in the experimental condition, we asked the participants to do a demanding cognitive task for 90 minutes nonstop. Believe me, it's very tiring mentally. It also activates certain areas of the brain that are associated with perception of effort, motivation, and effort-based decision making. So we select a very specific task. But also induce this general mental fatigue. So again, but no mental fatigue in the muscle, no fatigue in the heart, no glycogen depletion, no lactate accumulation. So it shouldn't have any effect. But it does. A significant reduction in time to exhaustion when mentally fatigued. This is actually equivalent. This reduction in time to exhaustion is equivalent of doing a time to exhaustion after doing 100 drop jumps to reduce the force of the locomotor muscles. And as I said, we measure basically all sorts of physiological measures that could explain the reduction in performance, but there was no effect whatsoever on cardiac output, oxygen consumption, lactate, peripheral fatigue, central fatigue, nothing, all the same. The only thing that changed was perception of effort, which was higher in the mentally fatigued condition. And as a result, they reached their maximal level of effort, because motivation was high in both conditions. We made sure that they were highly motivated, and we also checked. So they reached the same level of maximal effort. So there's no problem of motivation. The problem is that their perception of effort was higher, so they reached the moment at which they perceived that they gave their maximal effort and the continuation of the task was impossible. They reached it earlier than in the control condition. Control condition was just watching the movies for 90 minutes. Another one was using a little bit more weird manipulation, which is non-conscious visual cues. So we asked people, the brain is very sensitive to facial expression in humans for many reasons, obviously social. And there is a lot of research showing that some people even said there is a specific brain area. I'm not sure about that, but the brain is really sensitive to facial expression. And one way to do this is to use this facial expression to induce changes in, we call it affect or valence, so pleasant, pleasantness or unpleasantness in people. But in the way you do it subconsciously, that you ask people to do a cognitive task, which was a scanning visual vigilant task, while they were doing, actually, I think we did it for 5 minutes before the test, and then also during the test, the time to exhaustion test, they were looking at this screen, and they were doing this task. They didn't know that there was faces being shown to them. I'm not sure now if it's gonna, no. Can the operator click on the, because I can't from here, I didn't know that. Click on the first screen, please. So I removed all the other stimuli. This is called the mask. So before the stimuli appears on the video, what is it? It's gone already. Can you do it again? Here we go. You saw this, it was like a Turkish carpet, doesn't it? Here we go. But can you see anything else? Can you see something there? This is what they saw, okay? So if you can click on the second one, please. This is what their brain saw unconsciously, which is low down a lot. So now you can see their faces just before the appearance of the mask, but because it's so quick that you don't, you consciously you can't tell. But subconsciously, your brain perceives it. This is well, you know, it's a well done paradigm in cognitive neuroscience. And in one condition, we show them happy faces. In another condition, we show them sad faces. Because happiness is associated with sensation of, you know, joy and ease. And sadness is associated with, you know, depression. Everything is a struggle. So something being difficult, effortful, right? So the hypothesis was that we would have an effect on perception of effort, and we did. So first of all, we had a significant effect on endurance, on time to exhaustion. So they went much significantly further in happy versus the sad condition. And there was an effect on perception of effort, which was lower in the happy versus the sad condition. We also did the same with action in action words, but so I don't have time. To show that similar results. So action words like energy, go, they went better than things like tired or sleep, but they didn't see the words. We showed them subliminally, eh? They didn't see the words. So let's go now and explain a little bit about, okay, given the perception of effort is important, where does it come from? So if I ask you, how do you think perception of effort is created in our body? And ultimately in our brain, of course. Any suggestion? No, shy audience. Okay. Most people would say that perception of effort, and most of my colleagues as well still think that, although they're slowly changing, I'm changing their minds slowly. They're thinking that, like basically any other sensation, like pain, for example, or sense of tension in the muscles, etc. They comes from signals from the active muscles, but also they say from, for example, the heart or the lungs, from the organs active during exercise. They are innervated, they have receptors, there are pathways, they go to the brain, and then this afferent, we call afferent feedback from these organs is processed by the brain to generate perception of effort. That's the idea, okay? However, and in fact, you can see a high correlation between perception of effort and lactate and heart rate and things like that when you measure like people over different intensities. But having said that, you can probably correlate everything with perception of effort when you look at people exercising different intensities. You need to do experiments to find out. And these experiments, unfortunately, they are not being done to find out about perception of effort. They've been done for other reasons, but they are out there. It's difficult to find them, but there are quite a lot. One of them is this. So these people were exercising for 20 minutes at 55% of VO2 max, and there was a control condition. In the experimental condition, they were given an epidural in a way that they didn't paralyze them. There was a little bit of a reduction in force, about 20%, which is equivalent actually to kind of muscle fatigue, really. But they could cycle easily, but without any afferent feedback from the legs. So you would expect, if this idea that afferent feedback, the term, is the sensory signal processed by the brain to produce perception of effort, you would expect a increase or reduction in perception of effort. A reduction, right? No, it goes up. And the reason it goes up, but first of all, this idea of afferent feedback, gone. But also, it starts to suggest where else it could come from. Because one of the reasons, or the reason why it's higher, actually, in the epidural anesthesia, is because there was a little bit of motor impairment at spinal level, right? Because I put these slides for you guys, because obviously you're very interested in pain. And another way to test the theory is to increase. In the first study, they eliminated the afferent feedback. The other way to do it is to increase the afferent feedback. And one way to do it is to inject saline, hypertonic saline, in the muscle to produce sensational muscle pain. And as you would expect, when you do that, you have an increase in perceived pain, which is a completely different sensation from perceived effort. Don't mix them up. They are two completely different things, although a lot of people mix them up. But perception of effort, I don't have time to explain. This is what's called a production method, but this is an indirect measure of perception of effort, and there was no effect whatsoever of increasing afferent feedback from the bicep on the bicep perception of effort. So we can forget about this. What is it then? The other theory is that what we perceive as effort is a caloric discharge of the central command to the skeletal muscle, or to be more precise, obviously, to the motor neurons and then the skeletal muscles. The problem with that is that we didn't really have a lot of indirect evidence, for example, that study with the epidural, that if you get a little bit weaker, even if there's no afferent feedback, you perceive more effort, because you have to increase central motor command to compensate for the weakness. We didn't have a direct evidence. So the way we measure central motor command was using motor-related cortical potentials, which is the activity of these brain areas associated with movement. But usually people in neuroscience, they do moving the finger, because these techniques are very sensitive to movement, so they just move the finger to do a variety of interesting study, but there's not really relevant to exercise. So what we did elbow flexor with two different weights, but also we pre-fatigue one of the two arms with eccentric exercise that induces long-lasting fatigue, as you can see here, significant fatigue, and we asked them to lift the same weight, because obviously we expected that in order to lift the same weight with the fatigue muscle, you have to increase central motor command. So the combination of weight and fatigue created four different levels of perceived effort, as you can see here. And also here, zero is the EMG onset. So let's say the start of the contraction, kind of the EMG onset. This is brain activity before the onset of movement. And the contraction was 2 seconds, so this is the recovery. First of all, interesting to know that even 1 second before the movement, you have brain activity, but it wasn't affected by the manipulation. The only thing that was accepted was central motor command during the contraction, and in the direction that we expected. So higher load, which is this versus this, have more central command, and with muscle fatigue, which is the red line, you have to increase your central motor command compared to non-muscle fatigue. And this correlates significantly with ratings of perceived exertion. So I'm going to finish here. There is also other study. But importantly, I think, is the study I just showed you provides a link between muscle fatigue and performance. Because the problem has been that people thought that muscle fatigue was the direct limit of performance, of endurance performance. That doesn't mean And it's not, as I've shown you earlier. That doesn't mean the muscle fatigue is unimportant. It's still very important. Because if you do exercise with fatigue muscles, yeah, you have to increase center motor command. And this is perceived as an increased effort. And therefore, your endurance performance is impaired. It's just the way through which fatigue, muscle fatigue, affects performance is through perception of effort. But as I've shown you earlier, perception of effort is not simply a reflection of muscle fatigue. It can be affected psychologically, nutritionally, in ways that don't have anything to do with muscle fatigue. And that provides a variety of practical application, which do I have some time or? No, I'll leave it for the questions, maybe. If there is any question about possible practical application, I can answer them.
You're manipulating the questions. Yes. Now. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So any questions, especially about the practical applications?
Okay. Oh, anything but.
Yeah, tell something quick about the practical applications.
How do you run faster in a 5K? How do you drop 30 seconds tomorrow?
Tomorrow? Well, it depends what kind of athlete you are.
Incredibly elite, obviously. Mediocre.
Well, it depends what they, for example, if they are not used to use psychological skills, I think teaching them to use systematically some psychological skills can have an effect, such as self-talk. Also, I would definitely give them some of these if they're not using it, which is caffeine, which is not doping.
No, Provigil is doping.
Provigil is doping, but caffeine is not. And caffeine reduces perception of effort, but also reduces, this is brain activity doing exactly the same exercise, which was that knee extension thing, same force, same muscle recruitment, same EMG amplitude. So from a neuromuscular point of view, they were producing exactly the same output. But when you do that, after taking high doses of caffeine, your brain activity is much lower during the contraction. So it makes like your brain in a way more efficient. So you need less brain activity to get the same neuromuscular output. And that's translated into a reduction in perception of effort.
How much?
In that study was 6 milligrams per kilo body weight. So I think around 400 milligrams overall on that. Depends how big you are. These are things that you can do straight away. And indeed, a lot of athletes do. Something that we are looking at, I think acutely, there are things you can do. This also, we're looking at brain stimulation, everything. However, one thing that you can also do is to not to look at, make sure that from a psychobiological perspective, the athlete, the elite athlete arrives at the competition in a fresh state. And the problem is that you can control, you know, do your tapering from a physiological point of view, reduce the training load, et cetera, et cetera. But to reduce what we call the psychological load, the pre-competition anxiety, rumination, thinking, the bad sleep because you don't sleep because you're thinking about the competition, rumination, worrying, all these kind of things, and an emotional load can have an effect on perception of effort. So if you're, and it's not easy to remove those kind of, this psychological load from an athlete before a competition. So if you can, again, with psychologists, with the help of a psychologist, reduce this, you can have a significant effect, I think.
Okay, I think it's enough.
This is a,
just do you have a gun?
Because no, just to show you, this is a very good study. I wish I did it. I love this study. So this is a time trial. This is power during a 18 minutes time trial. No, not with elite, but you know, like fit people. And there were three conditions: control condition, nothing, and two other conditions. In both conditions, people were shown this disgusting video on YouTube, which is of an Asian woman vomiting and eating her own vomit. Yeah. What I did, you haven't even saw it. I watched it. It's even, you know, it's really disgust. So what you did is this. It's called disgust. It's a bit of an emotion, right? If I tell you to express your emotion as you did, that doesn't have a significant effect on performance. If I tell you, when you see the disgusting video, control your emotion, don't show it, there was a significant reduction in the power output during the simulated competition. Just by controlling your emotions related to watching this disgusting video. So psychological, let's call it psychological stress. It's actually the neurobiology of it. Yeah. It's quite interesting. Is
okay, Lele, yeah. It's
sorry.
Okay.
See, that's me. Sorry.
Thank you very much.